Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Against All Tides, the untold story of the USS Kitty Hawk race riot, by Marv Truhe, narrated by David Stifel. Preface. The date was October 12, 1972, during the latest escalation of the Vietnam War. The place was the Gulf of Tonkin in the South China Sea. The attack carrier, USS Kitty Hawk, was launching bombing runs onto North Vietnamese targets. At the same time, below her flight deck and through her labyrinth of passageways, numerous interracial confrontations erupted. It began with white Marines assaulting black sailors, and then white and black sailors assaulting each other, sometimes armed with makeshift weapons, including wrenches and broken-off broom handles. When the tumult finally ended several hours later, 51 crew members had suffered injuries for which medical reports were issued. By the time Kitty Hawk disengaged from Yankee Station and headed back to port in the Philippines, 25 black sailors were charged with rioting and with committing assaults on white sailors. Not a single white crew member was charged at that time. A few weeks later, my life became inextricably linked with those black sailors. My naval officer's uniform bore the military rank and insignia of a lieutenant in the Judge Advocate General's Corps. I was a JAG lawyer assigned to defend six of the accused in a series of special courts-martial trials at the Navy Station Law Center in San Diego, California. The unofficial Navy record of the Kitty Hawk incident, as well as virtually all other published accounts, would lead you to the likely conclusion that the sole perpetrators of the disturbance were black sailors, and all white sailors aboard that night were innocent victims and bystanders. I wrote this book to examine the veracity of those accounts. I did so by reviewing the critical events of that evening aboard Kitty Hawk, probing the Navy investigations that followed, and chronicling the ensuing courts-martial trials. My credentials for this endeavor are the 5 months of my life spent in intense preparation for and engaging in those trials. Since this is a first-person account, it necessarily includes my personal recollections. I am aided by my original case files, interview notes with clients and witnesses, and dozens of cassette tape recordings I dictated at the time. I also drew upon my personal copies of voluminous official Kitty Hawk documents, including witness statements, investigative reports, and trial and hearing transcripts. Finally, and importantly, you will hear from former Kitty Hawk defendants and Kitty Hawk lawyers who shared their stories with me for this account. During and after the trials, I assembled all the documents so someday I could bring to light the full Kitty Hawk story. That time is now, because even 50 years later, no publications or other accounts have captured the complete story, and too many have gotten it completely wrong. Almost none have included the perspectives of the black sailors aboard the Kitty Hawk that night, let alone the viewpoints of the 25 accused. The New York Times did cover some of the perspective of defense counsel, often using me as a source. The trials in early 1973 garnered national attention for months, and local television stations carried virtually non-stop reports. Print reporters set up camp outside the Navy Law Center, vying for a seat in the overflowing spectator section of the courtroom. Articles flowed from newspapers and news magazines throughout the country. More often than not, their headlines trumpeted USS Kitty Hawk race riot. When the trials began, a group of picketers were marching outside the gates of the San Diego Naval Station with banners proclaiming, "Free the Kitty Hawk 21. Politicians even joined in. A United States Congress subcommittee conducted daily hearings to investigate the Kitty Hawk incident. On January 3, 1973, just before I walked into a military courtroom to defend the first of my clients, the Congressional Subcommittee released its report to the national press. The subcommittee is of the position that the riot on Kitty Hawk consisted of unprovoked assaults by a very few men, most of whom were below average mental capacity, most of whom had been aboard for less than 1 year, and all of whom were black. This group as a whole acted as thugs, which raises doubt as to whether they should ever have been accepted into military service in the first place. As you will see in this narrative, virtually every assertion in that statement is pure fiction. I was honored to wear the uniform of a U.S. Navy officer, and am proud of and eternally grateful for those who have worn military uniforms in defense of our country. You will learn about some of them here. There are others, however, whom I have less respect for, and you will hear about them also. I witnessed racial injustice up close and personal while representing the Kitty Hawk sailors. My defense of those sailors remains to this day the most challenging and emotionally charged experience of my entire legal career. This, then, is the untold story of the Kitty Hawk incident and the trials that followed. Part 1. Kitty Hawk at Sea. Chapter 1. In the Beginning. Date, 12 October, 1972. Time, 15:30 hours. Location, U.S. Naval Station Law Center, San Diego. I was in my office reviewing witness statements for a desertion trial when the Law Center director dropped by. Captain Newsom wasn't stopping just to visit, as he sometimes did. He handed me a new case file. "I thought you'd like this one, Marv," he said. "Your guy is charged with sniffing jet fuel." "Seriously?" "Afraid so," he said. "He was on the Ticonderoga when the carrier's drug supply apparently dried up. They found him passed out next to a barrel of jet fuel with its lid pried off." "Sniffing jet fuel? Is that even an offense?" "I know," he said with a hint of a smile. "I thought you'd find it interesting." After almost 2 years as a JAG lawyer, I was no longer surprised at the files that crossed my desk. I had arrived at the Naval Station Law Center in January of the previous year, fresh out of Naval Justice School, and a newlywed of just over a week. San Diego was sunny that morning, just like most mornings, when I drove up to the Law Center in my 1962 blue and white Chevrolet Impala. The Law Center was a quiet, nondescript one-deck structure that looked over the San Diego Harbor. As I pulled up, I noticed a large steel-gray Navy vessel at the pier just beyond the palm trees on the front lawn. Although I was a U.S. Navy officer, I didn't have a clue what kind of vessel it was. It was probably because I hadn't paid much attention to such things during Naval Officer Indoctrination School. Every ship has a hull classification code. DE is a destroyer escort, LST a landing ship tank, and so on for more than 100 codes. We were supposed to memorize them, but for a bunch of soon-to-be Navy lawyers, we didn't see much point. An OIS classmate simplified it for us all by calling them GBBs and LBBs, great big boats and little bitty boats. After looking again at the vessel berthed across from the Law Center, I figured it must be a GBB. Now, almost 2 years later, I had learned one ship designator in particular, CVA, Aircraft Carrier Attack. In 1972, and throughout the Vietnam War, San Diego was home port for several of the 7th Fleet's 8 carriers, the Navy's largest warships. The 11th Naval District's facilities were sprawled over more than 4 square miles in and around the San Diego Harbor, a natural deep water anchorage. We judge advocates at the Law Center always had our hands full, usually juggling more than a dozen courts-martial cases at a time and having daily trials and other hearings. But when the fleet was in, it sometimes got a little crazy. With deployments to Vietnam lasting up to 10 months, crew members of the fleet often found time to get in trouble. Drugs flowing out of Southeast Asia were cheap and plentiful, and liberty hours in the away ports sometimes led to alcohol-fueled barroom brawls. Aboard, disciplinary issues ran the gamut from simple disrespect to petty officers to the occasional altercation between a couple of sailors. While at sea, ship's captains handled relatively minor infractions with captain's masts conducted on board, but more serious cases were left for us JAGs in San Diego when the ships returned home. On their arrival, especially carriers with up to 5,000 crew members each, our case dockets sometimes doubled overnight. I remember the carrier USS Kitty Hawk the most personally and unforgettably. It all started the same day the law center director stopped by my office, but halfway around the world. Date, 12 October, 1972. Time, 19:30 hours. Location, Gulf of Tonkin, South China Sea. U.S. Navy Carrier Group 77.7 was night steaming on a course of 335 degrees at a speed of 15 knots on Yankee Station off the coast of North Vietnam. The guided missile cruiser, USS Gridley, DLG-21, led the convoy, and 1,000 yards off her starboard quarter churned the colossal attack carrier USS Kitty Hawk, CVA-63. The task group flagship. Displacing 82,000 tons, fully loaded with aircraft and armaments, and almost a quarter mile long, Kitty Hawk was one of the largest warships ever built. With an onboard air wing, she carried a complement of 4,483 officers and enlisted men. Kitty Hawk was quite literally a floating city. Kitty Hawk's credentials and statistics matched her massive size. Launched in May 1960, she could steam at 32 knots into a stiff headwind while launching and recovering jet attack aircraft on her huge 4-acre flight deck. The ship's onboard Carrier Air Wing 11 had 107 aircraft, an air wing world record. That afternoon and evening, 12 October 1972, those aircraft were conducting non-stop bombing runs into North Vietnam from just 75 miles off the coast of Haiphong Harbor. Those operations continued until 20:30 that evening and resumed at 0800 the next morning. Before dawn broke on Friday the 13th, Kitty Hawk added yet another statistic to her credentials, and not a good one. She experienced an outbreak of confrontations and assaults between black and white crew members that lasted several hours. From that time to the present, that incident is known as the Kitty Hawk Race Riot. Some even call it the only shipboard mutiny in U.S. Navy history. That uproar did not arise suddenly out of the ocean depths like Poseidon, the Greek god of the sea. It had its origins in the too-long history of racial segregation and discrimination in the U.S. military that preceded it. That history is important in giving context to the Kitty Hawk story. During the Revolutionary War, more than 5,000 free black men fought for the colonists, despite General Washington's initial opposition. After the war, however, virtually all black men were excluded from the military. During the Civil War and after the Emancipation Proclamation, the Union began widespread enlistment of black men. They proved to be excellent soldiers, but were discriminated against in pay, pensions, and equipment. Of particular interest is that black men also served honorably in the Union Navy, making up fully one-fourth of its fleet. That ratio was double the black population of the country at the time. By the close of the Civil War, more than 38,000 black men had given their lives fighting for the Union cause. About 370,000 black Americans served in the U.S. military during World War I, although most were not allowed to serve in combat units. Those who were allowed in combat fought well and earned many honors. None who served, however, were exempt from racial discrimination. Toward the end of the war, French military personnel were directed not to treat black Americans equally, stating the official French desire not to offend white Americans in uniform. More than 1 million black men and women served in uniform during World War II. Initially, the Army was segregated into separate black units, always led by white officers. Later, the military began integrating, primarily due to military necessity. Even then, a large percentage of black personnel were relegated to driving trucks and performing menial tasks, such as laundry and kitchen duty. Some did find a way to get into combat. The exploits of the Tuskegee Airmen in North Africa and Europe, and the 92nd Infantry Division in Italy, are a lasting testament to the proud history of black men in uniform. 5 black soldiers received the Army's Distinguished Service Cross during the war, and 82 black pilots were awarded the Army Air Corps' Distinguished Flying Cross. But what does the history of black men and women in the military have to do with a racial confrontation on board Kitty Hawk a quarter of a century after World War II? Quite a lot, in fact. The Kitty Hawk story is centered in Westpac, the Western Pacific, and more specifically in the Vietnam theater. In the summer and fall of 1972, Vietnam was the Navy's hottest spot on the planet, and the hottest spot for a young seagoing sailor was serving as a crew member on an attack carrier on Yankee Station off the coast of North Vietnam. Fleet Task Force 77's carrier battle groups conducted operations from the Gulf of Tonkin in the South China Sea. 8 years earlier, in August 1964, the Gulf of Tonkin was the setting for America's full-scale commitment to the Vietnam War and its first insertion of combat troops into South Vietnam. As the war escalated, so too did America's ground troop commitment, until it had over 500,000 military personnel in Vietnam by 1968. By then, however, anti-war sentiment back in the States was becoming a political force that could not be ignored. Troop levels began to be scaled back, and by early 1972, it appeared America finally was on its way out of the quagmire it had gotten itself into. But in April of that year, the North Vietnamese launched a full-scale invasion into South Vietnam, later referred to as the Easter Offensive. In response, President Nixon ordered the institution of a dramatic increase in the air and naval campaigns against North Vietnam, aimed at convincing its leaders of the futility of continuing the war. Those orders committed the U.S. Pacific Fleet naval forces to a level of combat not seen before in the entire war. In 1971, the Navy's gunfire support ships averaged 2,000 rounds fired weekly. But following the 1972 Easter Offensive, those ships fired an average of 26,000 rounds weekly. That escalation also had a dramatic impact on the operational schedule of Kitty Hawk and its sister carriers of Task Force 77. During the 1968 Tet Offensive, the previous largest escalation of the war, the carrier fleet's daily aircraft sortie rate into North Vietnam averaged 218. But after the 1972 escalation, that increased to 337. Kitty Hawk's crew felt the impact of that escalation in more ways than one. Before that time, they could look forward to visits every 6 to 8 weeks in desirable liberty ports like Hong Kong and Yokosuka, Japan. That was not possible after the escalation. Except for one brief visit to Hong Kong, her crew's only port of call for nearly a year was the Subic Bay Naval Base and Olongapo City in the Philippines. Kitty Hawk had departed San Diego, its home port, 8 months earlier on 17 February, and on 12 October was beginning its seventh line period of the war. Each deployment to Vietnam was broken up by several line periods, which are those times spent in a combat zone conducting daily airstrikes and not in port or steaming to and from the combat zone. Kitty Hawk had a total of seven such line periods in 1972, the longest lasting 50 days, an inordinate amount of time. During its current line period, the task group was engaged in Operation Linebacker, an air interdiction campaign conducted into North Vietnam. Along with the shore-based U.S. 7th Air Force, the task force launched bombing runs at North Vietnamese targets in an attempt to interrupt the flow of supplies and enemy soldiers into South Vietnam. Since leaving San Diego, Kitty Hawk's 264 days of active deployment set a record for the longest of any attack carrier in the entire war. That time included 186 days actively engaged in airstrikes on North Vietnamese targets. Those combat sorties, often averaging 120 a day for sustained periods, were carried out by jet aircraft crews of the naval air squadrons attached to Kitty Hawk during the deployment. Kitty Hawk returned periodically to the Subic Bay Naval Base in the Philippines, 900 miles eastward across the South China Sea, for replenishment of supplies and munitions. Those short periods of time spent away from the grueling line periods were too few and far between for the young sailors. The ship's infrequent time in foreign ports typically lasted 6 days. But for most sailors, their liberty days were cut short by shipboard duty while in port. The stress of the extended line periods was heightened by Kitty Hawk's increasingly unpredictable schedule. That unpredictability began with Kitty Hawk departing its home port of San Diego 26 days earlier than originally scheduled. The crew was originally told the carrier would depart 14 March. However, in early February, they were told they would be leaving port almost a full month earlier. That created considerable hardship on the carrier's crew, whose home port schedules, travel plans, leave status, and shore housing were all geared to leaving a month later. A Marine officer on board talked about how those initial hardships were exacerbated by an ever-changing return date. We obviously deployed a month early, so as a result, many family-type problems or situations weren't able to be resolved, and because of the nature of the offensive in April, the ship's schedule itself was literally thrown out the window. So there was hope that perhaps the ship would return in August, September, or possibly as late as October, but no one really knew. There was an uncertainty in the air about the ship's schedule, and that uncertainty started from the day we left San Diego. A Marine corporal presented an enlisted man's perspective. There was no mail. Half the time we didn't get the mail. Our schedule was always messed up. They say you will be in PI, Philippines, on the 15th. We don't pull in, get overscheduled on the line another 10 days. That is just the morale. Way low, sir. The guys are working for something and we never get to do it. We would be out at sea for 30 days, and the guys want to go in and see the town and just don't get to see it because the schedules are all messed up. Townsend, the CO of the boat, tries to inform the troops that I am trying to get this, trying to get that, but he just can't. I guess he doesn't have enough pull. Personnel on board a carrier are assigned either to the permanent ship's company or to an onboard air wing. On 12 October, Kitty Hawk's company numbered 2,689 personnel, including its Marine detachment, and 1,794 personnel in the air wing. What about the enlisted crew of this attack carrier and its attack air squadrons? If you picture them as seasoned and battle-hardened veterans, a closer look may surprise. When a recruit entered Navy boot camp, it often was his first time away from home. In addition, many received shipboard assignments right out of boot camp. Of the 4,135 enlisted men aboard Kitty Hawk, almost half made up the three lowest ranks. Of that group, 100 were fresh out of basic training, in pay grade E1. Those in pay grade E2 numbered 530, and E3s numbered 1,196. Since E3s were at that level, were they seasoned veterans? Not necessarily. They could have attained that rank less than a year out of basic training. In short, the 1,826 men in the lowest three pay grades could hardly be considered battle-hardened veterans. How did these young sailors and airmen end up in the Navy aboard Kitty Hawk? A major factor was the Army draft during the Vietnam War, which began in the 60s and continued until the summer of 1973. How many of them, almost all teenagers at the time, had simply enlisted to avoid the Army draft? We have no way of knowing. However, living on a Navy base or on a ship at sea must have appeared decidedly preferable to slogging through the Vietnamese jungles, waiting for who knows what. In lieu of the Army draft, an 18-year-old could fulfill his service obligation in the Navy, Air Force, or Coast Guard. In opting for the Navy, perhaps an impressionable teenager had been lured by a friendly Navy recruiter's siren call. See the world, visit exotic ports, and all on the Navy's dime. If he ended up aboard an attack carrier like Kitty Hawk, however, he would quickly discover that his promised world would be limited to and confined within a massive steel vessel occupied by more than 4,000 men. Security forces on Kitty Hawk included a Master-at-Arms, MAA contingent, and a Marine detachment, MARDIT. The MAAs were the ship's police force, typically petty officers, responsible for maintaining onboard discipline and order. Their counterparts in other service branches are military police, MPs. The carrier had an MAA force of 30 men when an air wing was on board. The onboard contingent of Marines numbered 63, which included two officers. MARDIT's duties included backing up the MAA force. If the MAAs asked for help, the Marines could be ordered out by their commanding officer or someone at a higher command level. The Marines guarded high security areas of the ship, including its nuclear weapons, oversaw the ship's six brig confinement cells, and provided extra pier security while in port. The Marines lived apart in their own berthing area, and unlike the MAAs, did not have a regular presence throughout the ship. The commanding officer of Kitty Hawk, Captain Marland Townsend, acknowledged the heavy workload of his crew, but from his lofty perch, he saw things primarily in terms of the ship's overall mission. As a result, he seems to have overlooked how his crew's morale might be impacted by the stress of those mission demands and unpredictable schedule, and how that might have contributed to the later onboard tumult. When questioned about his crew's morale, he immediately shifted the focus to his pride in the carrier's combat missions. He conceded the crew's morale was flat when the 12 October incident erupted, but boasted how Kitty Hawk consistently flew a third again as many strike sorties as any other carrier, with up to 8 cyclic launches each day. Captain Townsend claimed his ship was far and away the best operator, the best in everything. "We did those things. I knew we could. I set it up that way, and we did it." That responsibility, of course, fell to his crew members. Air operations were typically conducted 12 hours a day, which meant flight quarters of 16 hours a day. Flight deck crew members, for example, worked 12-hour daily shifts during the weeks-long online periods. The ship had about 600 personnel assigned to the engineering department, and they often worked 6 hours on and 6 off, around the clock. The captain said it was safest to fly bombing runs at night, made possible because squadrons had Grumman A6E intruder twin-jet all-weather attack aircraft. They could cross into North Vietnam at 500 feet altitude in pitch-black weather and pouring rain. They could then drop down to 200 feet on their runs to avoid the radars of surface-to-air missile sites and anti-aircraft batteries. Nighttime sorties, however, meant many crew members had to work from dusk until mid-morning the next day, for weeks in a row. It was not just the unrelenting hours that contributed to the tension and stress. During the day and nighttime bombing runs, the steel bulkheads reverberated from shrieking jet engines and steam turbines driving its flight deck steam catapults and massive propulsion shafts. Sailors often took weeks, sometimes never, to acclimate to the cacophony before they got any useful sleep. And how about zero privacy around the clock, even when not on duty? Eating elbow to elbow, and sleeping on a row of racks stacked three high next to another row, and another. Shore-based sailors can go on liberty to get away from it all, but seagoing sailors have no such escape. Why don't we bring thousands of young men of different ethnicities and backgrounds together under these conditions, most away from home and family for the first time, and see what happens? What could possibly go wrong? Plenty, as it turns out. Chapter 2. New Commanding Officer. Date, 5 June, 1972. Time, 11:30 hours. Location, USS Kitty Hawk, off coast of North Vietnam. A change of command on any seagoing vessel can give rise to both anticipation and concern among the ship's crew. What is the new captain like? Will life go on as usual, or will he shake things up? The Kitty Hawk crew, and in particular the young black sailors, wanted to know how they would be treated by their new commanding officer, CO. Captain Townsend took official command of the Kitty Hawk on 5 June 1972, 4 months before the October incident. As with all officers holding top carrier command positions, he was a former Navy aviator. He entered Navy flight training as a teenager just 2 months after the end of World War II. During the Korean War, he flew F-9F Panthers off the flight deck of the USS Valley Forge. He later served as a Navy test pilot and commanded Fighter Squadron 121 in Miramar, California, later known as the Top Gun School. He was awarded the Bronze Star, Air Medal, and Distinguished Flying Cross. After command assignments on two other carriers, he was selected commanding officer, captain, of the Kitty Hawk. His illustrious career was to be severely tested in the days and weeks to come. Commander Benjamin Cloud, the executive officer, XO, was second in command, and had come aboard just 2 months before the October incident. Of black and Native American descent, he had an exemplary career as a Navy aviator before assuming command positions on carriers. Originally from San Diego, he began pilot training in 1952 at the onset of the Korean War. Upon receiving his wings, he was assigned to the VC-61 Fighter Reconnaissance Squadron in San Diego, which he later commanded. He was with that squadron when it deployed to Westpac in 1963. He flew recon missions into Vietnam in an RF-8 Crusader, taking photos of troop and transport movements on the Ho Chi Minh Trail while dodging anti-aircraft fire. After serving as protocol officer in the White House for two presidents, followed by more aviation duty, Cloud was deep selected to become the Kitty Hawk's number two. Among his other flying honors, he was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross. Marine Captain Nicholas Carlucci, the commanding officer of the ship's Marine Detachment, said Captain Townsend's replacement of the previous Kitty Hawk captain came as a sudden and unexpected shock to all. Carlucci reported aboard 2 years before the incident, by which time he had already distinguished himself in uniform. He enlisted in the Marines after college in 1968 during the Vietnam buildup, and earned his commission in Officer Candidate School. He later served a combat tour in Vietnam, followed by 2 years as an artilleryman instructor stateside. Commander Cloud had the impression that minority crew members felt the outgoing captain was not very sympathetic to their needs. He said minority sailors had hoped for a change or reprieve with the new captain. They soon found out, as shortly after Townsend came aboard, they witnessed how he handled disciplinary matters, including interracial incidents at captain's masts. Masts are a ship commanding officer's principal means for dealing with onboard disciplinary issues, and are typically reserved for minor offenses. Masts are the lowest level of disciplinary proceeding available under the Uniform Code of Military Justice, UCMJ. Masts are also referred to as non-judicial or Article 15 proceedings. If the ship's commanding officer determines the disciplinary incident is too serious to be handled at his mast level, he can send the case up one or more levels to be dealt with before a court-martial tribunal. In a mast procedure, the accused appears in person before the commanding officer and his charges are read to him. If he acknowledges his guilt, the hearing proceeds to sentencing. If he pleads not guilty, however, the ship's investigators provide details of the charged offense, and that is followed by witness testimony. The accused can also testify and bring out witnesses on his own behalf. If the commanding officer finds the accused guilty, he proceeds to the sentencing, with those potential punishments being substantially less than those possible at the higher courts-martial level. On 8 June, just 3 days after Townsend assumed command, he was presented with an interracial disciplinary matter. His handling of that incident, and all other interracial disciplinary matters after that, loomed large in the shipboard upheaval that followed. Date, 8 June, 1972. Time, 16:30 hours. Location, second deck, USS Kitty Hawk. The first interracial incident occurred when a white sailor was walking along the second deck and passed through a berthing compartment where several black sailors were sitting. He said one of the black sailors threw some popcorn kernels at him. Although not mentioned by the white sailor, Captain Townsend said the sailor responded by giving them the universal Italian sign. That is, the gesture of punching a fist into your elbow while raising the other fist. Several black sailors jumped up and pursued him. He ran up an escalator before they caught him, struck him repeatedly, and dragged him back down the escalator. The white sailor positively identified two of his assailants, an airman and a seaman. Assault charges were filed against them, and their cases were referred to a captain's mast. In a decision he later regretted, Townsend chose to follow his predecessor's lead and conduct masts in the ship's TV center so they could be taped and broadcast later on the ship's closed circuit system for the entire crew to witness. At the black sailor's masts, a ship's investigator presented the details of the assault. Both of the accused had witnesses appear in their defense, but Townsend found both guilty. Townsend sentenced the airman to 3 days in the brig with a diet of bread and water, and sentenced the seaman to 30 days in the ship's brig. In later testimony about the escalator incident, Townsend referred to the assailants as thugs. Townsend made a bold statement at that mast that every crew member watching on TV later remembered. He said that anyone who fights or commits an assault on his ship would be dealt with very harshly and severely. Townsend later confirmed his policy of dealing with onboard assaults. He said, "You go to the brig for 30 days and you are reduced in rate." The ship's crew now knew what to expect from their new commanding officer. The crew soon learned, however, that Captain Townsend's harsh punishments only applied to black sailors. With a white assailant, a completely different standard applied. Date, 8 June 1972. Time, 18:15 hours. Location, 5th deck, USS Kitty Hawk. The next interracial incident occurred later the same day as the escalator incident, only this time the roles were reversed. A white sailor assaulted a black E-1 airman recruit, a crew member fresh out of basic training. The recruit was performing extra duties in the number 3 machinery room using a high-pressure water hose. His supervisor was a fireman, an E-3 level white sailor. The recruit had lost control of the hose, causing it to flail about. His supervisor turned off the pressure to the hose and told him to pick it up again. The recruit reported that his supervisor said, "Either pick it up or I'm going to kick your ass," and, "We don't take no static from N-words down here." He apparently did not respond quickly enough, however, and the supervisor struck him in the back with a clenched fist. The white sailor was charged with assaulting the black sailor, and the case referred to a captain's mast. News of the incident circulated quickly among the relatively small complement of Kitty Hawk's black crew members, which numbered 297 men, or fewer than 7% of the ship's total company. Most waited in anticipation of how Townsend would handle the case. Commander Cloud said the feeling of the black sailors was, "Let's see what the captain will do when an assault was committed by a white against a black." 3 days after the hose incident, the accused fireman appeared before Captain Townsend's mast. However, instead of dealing with assaults very harshly and severely, as he earlier promised, Townsend simply dismissed the charges against the white sailor. In explaining the dismissal, Townsend said he didn't think the supervisor, a non-rated man, should have been put in charge of an extra duty man. Thus, in effect, Townsend blamed someone else for the white sailor's assault on the black recruit. That dismissal was especially egregious because of the supervisor's threat of bodily harm and the racial slur directed at the black recruit. Both constituted violations of the punitive articles of the UCMJ. The records do not reflect whether those additional charges were also filed against the supervisor, but would it have even mattered? Black crewmen saw the mast when it was replayed and were understandably outraged. Immediately thereafter, groups of black sailors gathered around the ship to vent their anger about the new captain's special brand of white man's justice. The disparity of sentencing later came to the attention of a congressional subcommittee, which was conducting its own investigation of the Kitty Hawk incident. Townsend was pointedly asked about his disparate handling of the two masts. Why shouldn't the white supervisor be punished for striking the black man? Captain Townsend replied that the blow was struck in anger and was not a planned assault. Therefore, since it wasn't premeditated, he argued it was not assault. That was preposterous. Premeditation is not an element of an assault under the UCMJ, so it is immaterial whether an assault is pre-planned. In making such a statement, Townsend was apparently trying hard to justify his refusal to punish the assailant. He then said something that must have further dumbfounded the subcommittee members. He told them that by dismissing the charges, he had passed up a great chance to win a lot of affection from the blacks. "I could have thrown that man in jail and been a hero, but I couldn't have lived with myself since that time either." The black sailors and the subcommittee members were not alone in questioning the disparate outcomes of the two masts. A Navy lieutenant gave a sworn statement to the onboard JAG investigator. The feeling among blacks was that the new captain was inconsistent at best. The lieutenant also talked about how some black sailors responded to that inconsistency. Following the second mast, groups of black sailors gathered on more than one occasion to discuss their feelings of frustration and anger about Townsend's actions. They finally decided to ask him to explain his handling of the two masts. Townsend responded by meeting with approximately 150 black sailors on the forecastle. During the two-hour meeting, Townsend attempted to explain his actions and discussed problems on the ship and possible solutions. In response to the sailors' request, he agreed to establish a full-time human resources committee to address future interracial problems. The sailors took the opportunity to air other grievances, including perceived discrimination in shipboard assignments and advancements in rank. That meeting and how it came about are important in several respects. A very large group of black sailors responded to the two contrasting masts by holding a series of peaceable meetings, with no hint of any improper motive. Their next actions likewise revealed the spirit in which they gathered. They asked Captain Townsend to personally meet with them, a very reasonable and appropriate reaction to his unequal treatment of black and white sailors. Finally, and significantly, about 150 black sailors met with Townsend out of a total black complement of 297 men on the ship. In other words, the perceived racial injustices administered by Townsend were so pervasive that fully half of the black crewmen showed up to hear him try to explain his actions. The grievances aired during the meeting with Captain Townsend probably included his practice of televising masts, which especially angered the black sailors. Who, after all, would want his transgressions aired publicly in such a humiliating way? Townsend himself later acknowledged the impropriety of broadcasting his masts. He said he realized the broadcasts angered the black sailors, but claimed that he only did so because his predecessor commanding officer had recommended the practice. When he first took command, Townsend said he even asked the ship's legal officer about it, because frankly, I thought it may be illegal. Nevertheless, he continued to broadcast the masts for months thereafter. Date, 19 July, 1972. Time, 0830 hours. Location, second deck, USS Kitty Hawk. A few weeks later, Townsend held his third mast involving a black sailor and a white sailor. For the second time in a row, a white sailor was the assailant. Black Airman Apprentice Perry Pettis was assaulted in the forward S2 head on the mess deck. He was on his way to sickbay to have a prescription filled and stopped to use a head a white seaman was cleaning. The seaman told Pettis the head was secured, but Pettis thought he was kidding because they had previously worked together compartment cleaning. The seaman was not kidding, however, and threw a can of scouring powder at Pettis, striking him in the face. When Pettis tossed it back, the seaman struck him in the eye with his fist. The seaman was charged with an assault, and his case referred to a captain's mast on 27 July. What would Townsend do this time? The televised mast undoubtedly drew an unusually large audience. Given the backlash from his previous two masts, Townsend could easily have taken the opportunity to show his black crew members that his future masts would be conducted without racial bias. Unfortunately, the 27 July mast simply reinforced the black sailors' feelings about Townsend's brand of shipboard justice. The white assailant received a monetary fine, nothing more. A petty officer who attended the mast said, "I believe he was fined $25, if I recollect right." The entire ship's crew learned the result of the much-anticipated mast. The black sailors learned about the outcome they probably expected. Not surprisingly, an interracial incident erupted immediately after. Date, 28 July, 1972. Time, 19:30 hours. Location, second deck, USS Kitty Hawk. The next evening, two black sailors were alleged to have gone into a berthing compartment and aggressively confronted and struck two white sailors with their fists. One of those victims was the seaman who had assaulted Pettis, and he was told by one of the black sailors that he was being repaid for that assault. Interestingly, that black sailor returned shortly after, asked the victim if he was all right, and told him it was all over. One of the black sailors was charged with throwing a shoe during the incident in the berthing compartment and hitting two white sailors. His case was referred to a captain's mast. Instead of meting out punishment at the mast, however, Townsend elected to take the extraordinary step of referring the case to a special court-martial proceeding. Given the alleged offense of throwing a shoe, that decision defied all logic. The court-martial was to be held when the carrier returned to the Subic Bay Naval Base. The accused never appeared at a court-martial tribunal, however, because he was given the option of accepting an undesirable discharge in lieu of standing trial. That discharge under less than honorable conditions is the most severe punishment that can be administered at other than a court-martial level, and stripped the sailor of all post-military GI benefits, as well as barring any future military service. The outcome was unheard of, given the nature of the charged defense. In his first few weeks on board, Captain Townsend dealt with four interracial incidents. His record was there for all to see. When black sailors assaulted white sailors, the sentences ranged from 3 days confinement on bread and water to 30 days confinement to a court-martial referral followed by an undesirable discharge. Yet when white sailors assaulted black sailors, an outright dismissal of the charges in one case and a $25 fine in the other. Townsend tried to defend his handling of those masts by saying that black sailors didn't understand that he took the accused's prior service records into account in his mast decisions. However, the official record gives no support for Townsend's inconsistent mast outcomes. In addition, his dictate that all assaults would be dealt with harshly and severely is flatly contradicted by his mast record. Those inconsistent outcomes led the Congressional Subcommittee to question Townsend about that inequality. Captain Townsend simply replied, "There is equality in mast procedure." He added, "They know damn good and well my record is fair." In an attempt to bolster his defense of his mast records, he told the subcommittee, "In our day and time, as competitive as our business is, a guy who is purely bigoted or something like that is never given a command." The Kitty Litter, a small publication, was sometimes referred to as an underground newspaper. It was neither officially sanctioned nor officially discouraged. No one seemed to know if it was even published on board. It was often critical of those in higher command positions, but many thought it valuable for those in mid-leadership positions who wanted to know what younger sailors were thinking and saying. An issue distributed 2 months before the October upheaval addressed Townsend's uneven handling of captain's masts. After detailing the outcomes of the masts and Townsend's attempts to defend his actions, the publication stated, "This is the same quality of argument as, I like blacks okay, as long as they know their place. Racism, it appears, is all right if the racist is in a position of power." The publication did concede that after Townsend's incident of blatant racism, he spent several hours talking to black sailors and adopted one of their suggestions, the formation of a human resources council. That concession seemed to suggest that Captain Townsend might have turned the corner in dealing with race relations. Whether he had, in fact, would be put to the test a few weeks later, when the Kitty Hawk returned to Subic Bay. Another interracial incident occurred, and this time Townsend could not simply pass it off with dismissive or defensive statements. Chapter 3. Trouble in Subic Bay. Date, 4 September, 1972. Time, 1945 hours. Location, Subic Bay Naval Base. On 4 September, Kitty Hawk disengaged from Yankee Station and set sail for Subic Bay in the Philippines. After completing her fifth line period since leaving San Diego in February, the sailors couldn't wait for the much-anticipated break. 3 days later, the carrier steamed into Subic Bay and tied up at the Kubi Point Naval Air Station dock. Farther into the bay lay the Subic Bay Naval Base. It would be an understatement to say Subic Bay was a busy port. During the Vietnam War era, more than 30 Navy vessels entered the harbor each day. The Subic Naval facilities at the time spread out over 262 square miles, and it was the largest U.S. Navy port in the Western Pacific. It was a major supply and ship repair facility and home away from home for much of the 7th Fleet. Just beyond the Subic Bay Naval Base's main gate and a bridge lay Olongapo City, the quintessential Navy town for sailors on liberty. During the escalation of the 7th Fleet's operations in 1972, however, Olongapo was overwhelmed with sailors because all the 7th Fleet's ships used Subic Bay's port services. From January to October of that year, more than a million sailors were on liberty in Olongapo, with the Liberty Party reaching 20,000 men some nights. On entering the town, a sailor found himself in a whole new world, appearing to some as exotic, but to others as seedy. From Magsaysay Drive to Rizal Avenue and beyond lay endless bars, nightclubs with live music, tattoo parlors, restaurants, and brothels. Turning left at the Rizal traffic circle led to the jungle, an area dedicated to attracting black servicemen. Turning to the right sent you to the Strip, an area where mostly white sailors hung out. Captain Nicholas Carlucci, the CO of the carrier's marine detachment, believed Olongapo provided the perfect catalyst for interracial confrontations, since it was, to all appearances, a segregated town. He said the segregation fed rumor upon rumor that went unchecked by anyone. The town wasn't strictly segregated, however. A black Kitty Hawk sailor said some white crew members liked the bars, music, girls, and nightlife better on his side of town, and they would often ask to go with him and other black sailors to the jungle. He was perfectly okay with that, but it really upset him that many of those port buddies refused to have anything to do with him back aboard. He attributed some of that to criticism they encountered from other white sailors if they were ship buddies with him or other black sailors. Taking the 2-hour bus trip to Manila, the capital city, was an option, but not one seriously considered by most. That was especially true 2 weeks after Kitty Hawk arrived back in port. In late September 1972, Philippines President Ferdinand Marcos declared the entire country under martial law. Date, 13 September 1972. Time, 2300 hours. Location, Olongapo City, Luzon, Philippines. During Kitty Hawk's mid-September layover at Subic Bay, several black crew members reported that a white shipmate was paying Filipino nationals to assault black sailors whenever they ventured into Olongapo on liberty. Even though the white sailor was identified, no investigation occurred at the time. The reports were confirmed on 13 September, the carrier's last night in port. Just before midnight, an incident occurred on Rizal Street in the jungle section of Olongapo. According to several black Kitty Hawk sailors, a white Kitty Hawk sailor accompanied by four nationals randomly assaulted them and other black sailors. One black eyewitness reported that the white sailor was the instigator and was not only throwing punches, he was directing nationals in their assaults on black sailors. Another black sailor said the white sailor hurled a racial slur at him, and he was then struck in the face by a national, suffering a facial laceration requiring 8 stitches to close. Another black sailor was assaulted and also required medical treatment. 3 other black eyewitnesses stated the nationals were using knives and rocks during the confrontation. 5 black victims and witnesses gave sworn statements to Kitty Hawk's chief investigator. The investigator followed up by having them view a lineup on board the ship with the white sailor and 4 other white sailors, whom he described as having very close likenesses to the accused. 3 of the 5 black sailors picked out radio man seaman apprentice Alan Sickles as the assailant. The investigators also identified the 4 Filipino nationals involved, who happened to be otherwise employed as Naval Base Subic Bay security guards. But before they could be questioned, 2 of them suddenly quit their jobs and disappeared, so they could not be interviewed. The other 2 admitted going to the jungle with Sickles that evening. They even called him their American friend and admitted to drinking with him just before the incident, yet both denied taking part in the assaults. Sickles admitted that he and his Filipino friends were involved in a fight with the black sailors, but denied starting the fight. The ship's investigative report concluded that Sickles and the nationals had trouble on their minds when they went into the black area of Olongapo, and that it was the mutual feeling of the investigators that the PI nationals were untruthful. Sickles was charged with an assault and appeared before Captain Townsend at a captain's mast. No record was found, however, of any disciplinary action taken against Sickles, apparently for the reasons Townsend explained to the Congressional Subcommittee. He did so in response to a Time magazine article on the Kitty Hawk incident. Townsend said that report of the jungle incident was circulated by blacks, and only a few blacks made the charge that a white sailor had hired the nationals. He also said the ship's investigators questioned the nationals and could find no evidence they were hired. These were the same persons his own ship's investigators believed were untruthful. The allegations against Sickles were made in sworn statements by 5 sailors from Townsend's own ship. 3 had positively identified Sickles, and 2 had suffered head and facial lacerations. After hearing Townsend say he took no action because only a few blacks made the charge, one might well ask, how many sworn statements from how many black sailors would it have taken for him to discipline Sickles? Kitty Hawk returned to Yankee Station at its 6th line period on 16 September. No onboard interracial incidents were reported during that line period, which lasted until 2 October. The carrier then returned to Subic Bay. Date, 9 October, 1972. Time, 23:45 hours. Location, Main Gate, Naval Base, Subic Bay. Kitty Hawk arrived back at Subic Bay on 5 October and docked at the Naval Base's Oliva Pier, rather than its usual mooring at the Kubi Point Naval Air Station. The Oliva Pier was used if ship maintenance was needed. Sailors preferred it to Kubi Point because from there it was an easy walk to the nightlife in Olongapo, instead of having to take buses from the Kubi Point Naval Air Station. During that October stay, several more interracial incidents occurred. They were investigated by Captain Bobby Hatch, the Assistant Chief of Staff to the Commander of the U.S. Naval Forces, Philippines. That informal JAG manual investigation produced testimony and more than 30 sworn statements. The first incident occurred just before midnight on 9 October, outside the main gate of the Subic Bay Naval Base. Airman Dwight Horton, a black Kitty Hawk sailor, was returning alone to the ship when two white sailors came up behind him and one uttered a racial slur. As he turned around, one of the sailors grabbed him and threw him to the ground. He tried fighting back but had difficulty, as his right arm was in a cast, having been broken earlier. Both the sailors were assaulting him when shore patrolmen arrived. They took his assailants and two white eyewitnesses to the Naval Base Security Office. Horton was first taken to the Naval Base Medical Facility because of injuries to his eye, wrist, and hip, and then to the Naval Base Security Office, where an investigator was taking statements. Horton asked to make a statement, but the investigator kept telling him to shut up. He eventually just gave up and returned to the Kitty Hawk on his own without anyone ever talking to him. The two white eyewitnesses who gave statements were from another ship. They both said that Horton was the victim, not the perpetrator. One said the assailants yelled the N-word at Horton and then threw him down and started hitting him. One of the assailants claimed Horton initiated the fight after his intoxicated friend said loudly his distaste for people. His friend admitted he was quite drunk at the time, but claimed he was only carrying on and laughing, talking about naval black shoes as they walked up behind Horton. Captain Hatch, the JAG investigator, reviewed the witness statements but took no action on the incident. He gave no reason, simply saying, "I didn't pursue the matter any further." When the Kitty Hawk was again at sea, Horton was summoned to the ship investigator's office. Expecting to be told of action taken against his assailants, he was instead told he was suspected of an assault against the shore patrolman who had come upon the scene when he was being assaulted. Nothing came of that allegation against Horton. Horton did tell the ship's investigator that when he returned to the ship that evening after the incident, his black shipmates asked about his injuries. When he told them what happened, they were really unhappy about it. After the Kitty Hawk left port, Captain Townsend conducted his own investigation into the Horton incident. He concluded it was black word against white word as to who instigated the fight. He did say, however, that since Horton was alone and had his right arm in a cast, it was not unreasonable to believe Horton's statement that he did not initiate the attack. Despite Townsend's statement about Horton's veracity, he likewise chose not to pursue charges against the two white sailors. Identifications were not an issue, of course, given the written statements made by Horton's two assailants, and still he chose not to charge anyone because it was a black word against white word situation. In fact, the two disinterested white sailors who witnessed the assault had corroborated Horton's statement that he was a victim and not an assailant. Therefore, it was one black sailor and two white eyewitnesses' word against that of the two white assailants. Townsend had again come up with a reason, however illogical and indefensible, to take no action against white sailors assaulting a black sailor from his own ship's company. Date, 10 October, 1972. Time, 22:30 hours. Location, Sampaguita Club, Naval Base, Subic Bay. The evening after the Horton incident was Tuesday, 10 October, and the Kitty Hawk was scheduled to set sail the next day. Ship crews took full advantage of their last hours of liberty, and the Kitty Hawk crew members were no exception. Some Kitty Hawk sailors said what occurred that evening on the naval base was a contributing factor in the outbreak of onboard confrontations just 2 days later. The Sampaguita Club on the Subic Bay Naval Base was for enlisted men, and every Tuesday night was Soul Night, which drew an unusually large contingent of black sailors from the naval base and black crew members from ships in port. That evening, more than 700 patrons, black and white, including some wives, clocked in at the club. By early evening, the security office started receiving reports of fights on and off the naval base. Some were interracial altercations, and those became the source of fast-circulating rumors. A white Kitty Hawk airman and his friend were in the club getting drunk and witnessed a few fights. The club manager reported that most of the fights were between white and black sailors. Just after midnight, a fight erupted in the club that could not be controlled by the assigned shore patrol. Additional SPs were called, and they reported not a riot at this time, but as a fight of considerable portion going on at the club. Most of those fights were between white and black sailors, and still could not be contained. So the Marine Riot Squad was called from the Naval Base Marine Barracks. They witnessed a confrontation at the back of the club between a white sailor and some black sailors. A Marine officer decided to eject the black sailors from the club, and his troops began pushing them toward the front entrance. No weapons were used, and no blows were struck, but just then, someone inside the club smashed a bottle, and all hell broke loose. Some black sailors broke free from the Marines and began picking up chairs and bottles and throwing them, then ran outside. A short time later, the club was shut down for the evening. Several white sailors were also engaged in that upheaval. Four were detained by the Marines, evidently with some resistance, because two of them received head injuries. One asked, "Why is it whites you are hitting and not the blacks?" Marines then swept the naval base looking for large groups of blacks, even though white sailors had also been involved in the fights. Interestingly, other than the four white sailors originally detained, the only other apprehension was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.